Welcome to the show, and as you can see, this isn't Tony.
No, it's not. What a marvellous observation, Alan.
This is Sarah. Bless her, all the way down from Richmond.
Yes, they know that now.
Right? Yeah, I know.
Yeah, they're bored of that one.
I know. Never mind.
Right.
There's loads on the show this week. Where are we going first? We're going to wonderful Wilton House.
That's Tony's job. That's where he is.
That's Tony at Wilton. So with Tony in Wilton, we've got the Romsey Show. Did you go there?
I didn't, actually. I missed out on that one. Too busy at a wedding.
Tony went there as well. Oh, you went to the antiques, though, didn't you?
I did. That was fun. Yeah. Bit of a lovejoy. Mm.
Yeah. With Billy Murray. And I went to the Stranglers. I promised you that last week.
No.
That's going to be really good. Yes. Sheer rock and roll on Town TV.
That suits you.
And stay tuned for the competition coming up. This wonderful pine coffee table, wow, which will win later in the show. So there we are. It's over to Wilton House. Thanks, Sarah. Bye.
That's okay.
One of the beautiful houses of England, which is on our very doorsteps. And I've never been here before. I've passed it many times. But today we decided to come in and have a look around. It's Wilton House. Shakespeare was here. Kings and queens of England were here. All of them. So we're going to have a look around and show you what's on your doorstep. I found Alan Williams, who's the tourism and marketing manager, who's going to show us around the house. It's nice to see you, Alan.
Thank you for coming.
How long have you been here now?
Well, I've been here about 3 years, but that's nothing compared to the history of the house, which traces its history back nine centuries, to the time when there was a nunnery here. Mm-hmm. We still found some foundations of a 12th century abbey. And then what we're looking at today behind us here is the Inigo Jones house that dates from the 17th century.
So Inigo Jones designed and built this place?
He did. He started off with some designs in the 1630s. Mm. And then we had a fire in 1647 and his nephew John Webb took over from him and finished off the internal decorations.
Do you get many tourists coming through here?
We're about 100,000 people per year.
Yeah. But you want more?
We could always do with more, yes. But very expensive to upkeep a house of this quality.
Yes. But I've had a quick look around and I didn't even know the house was this good, if you like. I didn't know the quality of the house. I've passed here many times and never been in. This is the first time I've been here and I just can't believe it.
It's always hidden away, isn't it? You can't actually see it from the road. But when people come, they're just knocked out by it, as you've been. Mm. Not simply as a spectacular stately home, but also as a home. They get the feeling that it is lived in.
It is lived in now, isn't it?
The 17th Earl, yeah. The Earl of Pembroke, lives here with his family.
But, I mean, it's the cube rooms and the double cube rooms, I didn't know what that was. I read some literature about it. What does a cube room mean?
Well, the single cube is 30 feet by 30 feet by 30 feet.
Oh, I see.
And the double cube room, obviously, is twice the size. Mm.
There's been some films made here recently, hasn't there?
Yes, the last 2 years we've had The Madness of King George with Nigel Hawthorne, and then last year we had Emma Thompson here and Sense and Sensibility.
We had Emma on the show recently, which was nice when they did the gala performance for that in Winchester, wasn't it? Yes, it was. So, what's the plans for the house at the moment? Have you got any other plans to do anything with it?
Well, we're always looking for new things and new events that will bring people in, so that we can show off what there is to see here at Wilton House. Yeah. We've got some costumes in at the moment from Sense and Sensibility, some new costumes. We had some in the spring, but this is a completely new range now, all principal actors.
Oh, right. Now, what's this? I saw one of the brochures, have a go or something like that, days that you have here.
Well, last weekend we had some lace makers in from Downton, just down the road, and they were not only demonstrating how lace making takes place, but also offering people the chance to have a go themselves.
That's excellent. Do you have I mean, the whole setting is ideal for orchestras and things like that. Do you ever have concerts here?
We've had a couple of concerts. The spectacular one was last month. when we had the Bournemouth Sinfonietta here with an open-air classical extravaganza. Mm-hmm. It was only spectacular in 1995, but this year it was an extravaganza with fireworks after it. And that was quite spectacular. The bridge here behind us was actually open. Car parking was in the field, so people were walking over the bridge, and they were seated all on the lawns with a quite spectacular concert of light classical music.
Missed that one. I wish we'd got that.
You'll have to come next year.
When are you going to have to tell us about
19th of July.
This?
19th of July next year.
Throughout the years, Alan, there's been some very, very famous people that visited this house. Can you name some of them for us?
Henry VIII.
Good Lord, that's famous.
Elizabeth I, Charles I, Winston Churchill, Montgomery, Eisenhower. Wilton has been visited by virtually every king and queen of England since the time of Henry VIII.
Even our present queen?
The present queen was here just last year.
Oh, really?
Yes, yes. And, of course, during the Second World War, this was headquarters for Southern Command. Mm-hmm. So we had Winston Churchill, George VI came here, Montgomery, Eisenhower, all to look at the preparations for the D-Day landings.
Now, why did I see a statue of Shakespeare?
Well, Shakespeare, at the time of the second and third Earls, Wilton was very much like what we would consider a university to be today, a seat of learning. Yeah. And it's reputed that William Shakespeare and his performing players first did As You Like It and possibly even Twelfth Night here.
The first performance here?
First public performance of As You Like It here at Wilton House. You missed that as well, didn't you?
Well, I'm old enough. I should have been here. So, you said you're going on to do some events for next year. Can you name some of the things that's going to happen?
Well, we're going to have an Easter egg treasure hunt quiz for the children. That'll be round the house. We get lots of children on Easter Sunday. And it's a way of enjoying themselves around the house and finding out about the history as well. The craft fair will be back again at the beginning of May.
Is that very popular?
That's very good. And, of course, we opened the bridge here again, so people can actually walk from the craft fair field behind us over the bridge and visit the house. And then you've got the open-air concert. And we're looking at something possibly about Jane Austen.
Oh, really?
Very popular at the moment.
Yeah, yeah, because of the film.
Because of the film. And we've got the links with Jane Austen through the Sense and Sensibility film.
Yeah.
Watch this space.
Right, we're going to advise you when things come up in Wilton House. As and when they happen, we would tell you a while beforehand, so give you a bit of time. Alan, thanks very much for talking to us.
Thank you, Tony. Thanks for coming.
So we're going to have another look around with the camera now.
Let's take the camera into the house.
Cheers.
Okay. We're here in the double cube room looking at the painting of the fourth Earl by Van Dyck, one of all the paintings here by Van Dyck in the double cube, and below it is this wonderful sofa covered in Wilton carpet. This was put here in about 1830, the oldest of the Wilton carpets in Wilton House, and it was commissioned by the Russian Countess, the wife of the 11th Earl. Looking here at some photographs of the present Earl and his sister with their father, the 16th Earl. The present Earl, who created the memorial garden in the North Forecourt in 1971, 2 years after he succeeded to the title. We'll be right back.
I hope you enjoyed that. We certainly have, the crew. We've enjoyed having a look around here, something that we didn't even know. And once again, let's thank Alan for inviting us here today to have a look around and for having a chat with us. The hospitality here was wonderful. Come and visit Wilton House. You will enjoy it. What's your name?
Mr. Capp.
Mr. Capp?
Mr. Capp.
And where are you from?
Up north, up north. We've come down here to sample your local brew and your local talent. Have you met the wife, Flo?
Hello, Flo. Nice to meet you.
And you.
And you're down with the old man?
My husband, yes.
What's the matter? It's been a bit of a row or something?
He's always after Tutty.
Tutty?
Tutty.
Oh, is he?
Bit of crumpet in his anyone's.
Well, what are you doing down here, anyway?
Well, we've come down to do a show at Cricklade Theatre on the when is it? It's the 3rd, 4th and 5th of October. There's a load of us come down, a great big coach load. There's my mate Chalky, and there's her mate Ruby.
Oh, Ruby's here as well.
Oh, Ruby's here. She's everywhere. Oh, I've got me young nephew Elvis. He's coming down. He's coming.
Elvis is coming.
He's not a full shilling, is Elvis.
Isn't he?
And he's bringing his young woman. That's a nice bit of crumb. He's bringing his young woman Raquel down, and there might just be a wedding. We don't know yet, but there might be. And what else do you want to know?
Well, what sort of a show is it?
Oh, it's a musical. It's a lovely musical. We've all got cracking voices. We all sing. Oh, aye, sing really well. We do really well.
Mr. Capp.
And there's plenty of yavin. Loads of yavin.
Plenty of what?
Yavin.
What's that?
What's yavin? I'll have a pint, please.
Oh, right. Caught again. I'm always getting caught with this show. Who wrote this show?
Some bloke called Alan Price.
Not the one from The Animals?
He might be an animal, I don't know. Alan Price, that's right. Plays a bit on the old Joanna.
We used to play with our good friend Georgie Fane, didn't we?
He did that, yeah. Georgie Fame, he played the old piano as well, didn't he? Up north.
Yeah, we
go. Oh, aye. He used to come round our pub quite often, didn't he? Bashing out, trying to make a few bob.
So, Andy, how many's in the company that's coming down?
Oh, there's a load of us, isn't there? There's, 20-odd, 30-odd, 40-odd, I don't know. There's loads of us.
We all fit in Cricklade stage?
Oh, yeah, we'll fit in. Provided they got a bar, we'll all fit in somewhere.
Well, they usually have some sort of hospitality there.
Hospitality.
You got me going.
Aye, they've got plenty of that there, and they've got plenty of beer, aye.
So tell us again what the date is.
It's the 3rd and the 4th and the 5th of October. And you've got to come in and put a pint behind the bar for me, but remember to save enough money for a ticket, because it's a show you'll not want to miss. There's lots of singing and dancing and goings on, isn't there, Flo?
Flo? Who's this woman here?
I don't know. Right little tart, isn't she?
Is she local?
She must be. I don't know her.
What's she doing around Andy then?
I don't know, but I'm soon going to find out, thank you.
You've got your handbag handy there, haven't you?
It always comes in handy, thank you, love.
I'm getting out of here before the fireworks start.
See you later.
See ya.
Andy!
Oh, quiet, Flo, don't hit me again!
The choice is yours at Next Import, whether your requirements for a bedside chest, three-piece suite, armchair, a fully fitted bedroom or pine furniture. A selection of over 100 beds in stock, all sizes from 2'6" to 5', with mattresses a speciality. Immediate free delivery from stock and all available at the lowest prices. We're open from 9 to 6 Monday to Saturday and late until 8 on Fridays. Situated at the Commercial Centre, picket piece with ample parking. Next Import, your premier bed and furniture centre.
At Freelance, we have a full range of garage doors on display, from wood, fiberglass, steel, manual and automatic. We offer a full service from fitting to maintenance to spares on a wide range of doors, including Henderson, Cardale and Garador. No job is too large or too small. No call-out charge. Why not visit our showroom at Wadham Business Park, Alderbury, near Salisbury? Or phone us on Salisbury 01722 711 200.
Whatever your industrial cleaning requirements, for window cleaning and floor care when only the best will do. carpet cleaning to washroom, kitchen and bathroom hygiene services. Call the professionals for that extra sparkle that really counts. Call Oasis Cleaning and Maintenance on Salisbury 01722 320 577.
Wonderful Saturday and the sun, it couldn't be a better day for the Romsey Show. We're going to have a look around. I'm going to do an awful lot of interviews and talking and just want to show you what's happening at Romsey Show this year. So follow Steve around with the camera.
Thank you. I'm standing outside the offices on a glorious Monday morning, and Bill Murray and myself, Bill's right beside me, are going to do a bit of a love joy, aren't we, Bill?
We are, that's
Where
right.
Where are we going?
We're going to Bob Herbert's saleroom, Andover saleroom, just down the road, about 300 yards away from us.
One of his famous auctions.
Every fortnight, well known, does everything from jewellery to furniture. Really interesting stuff.
And we've got the car. A pink Rolls Royce. Apparently it's faded Tudor red, but I think it's pink and I think it's really cool. Shall we go?
Let's go.
Excellent.
Right.
Who's driving, Bill?
You are.
Oh, no! Right, well, we're in the middle of an auction here. We can't interrupt Bob because he's a very busy man and he's going to be auctioneering all afternoon. So we're just going to do a little profile on Bob from the sidelines, are we
That's
not?
Right, yeah.
And we're talking in sotto voce terms.
Sotto voce, very quietly.
Very, very quietly. So for those of you who haven't been to an auction room before, this is a very busy place.
Don't wave your paper, you're just buying something.
Oh, crumbs, yeah. Sorry, Bob, yeah. Gone for a pound. Well, I'll tell you what they sell here. They sell all sorts of Victorian and Edwardian furniture, clocks, general furniture, household goods, and four times a year they actually have a houseplant sale. So, really, they cover just about everything, don't they?
Everything, yes.
You know quite a lot about Bob, don't you? Because you've known him for many years.
I was at Bob's first auction, 30 years ago, I think it must have been, when actually the space here was a lot larger than it is now, but he had less stuff here. Now he gets so much crammed into such a small space, it's quite amazing. I mean, it's just that Sarah and I are having to cuddle up in a little corner to do this piece. But nobody's
watching.
There's
so many people.
That's right, yeah.
And actually, something did just go for a pound.
So you bought it.
Yeah, I didn't realise. But they do cover sort of just about everything,
yes,
don't they?
From thousands of pounds all the way down to a pound.
Right.
Yeah.
Are we going to have a little look round?
Yes, we'll have a look round.
Magic.
I'll show you some bits and pieces that he's got, some interesting bits and pieces.
Okay.
And, of course, the most interesting bit and piece is Bob Herbert, who's over my shoulder, selling like nobody's business.
It's only 1:45 and they're actually providing drink outside. I've decided I quite like this place. Bill, over here. Talk about this table to me.
I have to tell you, Bob doesn't provide drink at every sale, only this one, which is his 500th.
And we're staying late.
Very special day. Cheers, Daddy.
Tell me about some of these pieces, Bill, because I know nothing about antiques.
Well, this
I quite like this one. It's quite pretty.
Yeah, it's quite pretty, but it's not antique.
Is it not?
It's a reproduction, made quite recently.
Sorry to be so ignorant, but how can you tell?
It doesn't have the patina which it should have. It hasn't got the years of polish build up on it. It's got a varnish-type finish to it. You can feel underneath it's a bit rough. It's a very pretty table.
It is pretty.
But it's not what it looks.
So what sort of price would that go for, then, as a repro?
Probably about £150.
Really?
Yeah. I should think a great deal more if it were real.
Could fool people like me.
Good. Let's try and do that.
It's Jemima Puddle Duck. Why would someone want to buy something like this?
It's pretty, it reminds them. But again, it's modern. It's not
old.
It's not antique.
That's going to be a fiver, isn't it, really?
Yes, possibly. However,
this
camera here. This is an early Mammoth steam engine. Very, very collectible. Actually works. Made in the period round about 1938, probably, that was made. Beautiful piece of work. Probably £200. Nice piece.
605, no knock tag on a one, couple of pounds, two bid, three is it.
Are we going to have a bit of a bid?
Yeah, all right. Let's try. Should we try and buy that?
I think we've got to go and try and buy something.
Or do you want Jemima?
I don't...
You
I
want
don't,
Jemima,
I want
don't you?
I a bit of a budget, you see, Bill.
How much
so.
You got?
I'm not going to tell you.
Jemima.
I think it might be.
We're going to have to buy Jemima.
I think Jemima it is.
4607, had a lack of one, circular lack of one, that is £30. 20, 10, I 10 on bid, 12 worth. 12 is it? Solid, £10. 12, 14 now, £12. Stacey.
That was brilliant. I've bought something really good. I'm just going to go and collect it. See you in a sec.
Sarah's gone to pick up Jemima Puddle Duck, which she thinks she's bought. In fact, she made a very strong bid on this little table. actually quite seriously. A nice little table. Gypsy barley twist legs, painted. Needs stripping down. She paid 12 quid for it. It's probably worth about 80, so she hasn't done badly. That is what you do at auction if you've never done it before. You never know what you're going to buy.
I'm going for a wind chair. Yesterday it was hot and I was in winter clothes. Today it's cold, I'm in summer clothes. I'm not happy. But I'm going off to the Anvil. We're down to Basingstoke where lots of stars are appearing. I'm going to meet Hinge and Bracket, and I'm going to meet a comedian who's an up and rising star, and I'm going to meet Uncle Albert. Can't wait for Many Fools and Horses. So see you down there. Well, this is a wonderful moment in my career. I'm actually sitting beside Dr. Evadne Hinge and Dame Hilda Brackett. Try and say that when you've had a couple of drinks. Good morning.
Dr. Evadne Hinge and Dame Hilda Brackett.
I have a couple of drinks, I'll try and say it.
She's enjoying herself.
Because I talk
herself,
to myself, you know. Yes, I've been there. Yes.
You're good today, aren't you?
I'm
she
right.
Doesn't get out very much.
No,
and I said, I tell you what, I'll take you to Basingstoke and you can live.
Oh, lovely.
So, yes.
Do you feel you are living this morning in Basingstoke?
Not quite yet. Do you give me half an hour and a couple of shares?
There's only tea on the menu here, ladies.
No, not so good.
Ladies.
Yes, dear.
You have done several pantomimes, haven't you, in the years?
Yes.
Large number.
Cinderella, Fairy Godmother. Evadne, we've not done that one together, so Evadne's not been in there. Beauty and the Beast and the Sleeping Beauty.
I've done many more. I've done Robinson Crusoe. I've done Dick Whittington before, of course. Mm-hmm. Cinderella, Sleeping Beauty.
What, why do they
Beauty
speak
and the Beast. I've not finished yet, dear. Beauty and the Beast. Snow White, The Wicked Queen, my favourite role.
Really?
But this year, Queen Rat and Dick Whittington at Basingstoke.
How bad can you get?
Oh, you'll have to come and see, dear, but I can be rather naughty.
and without the aid of makeup. Yes, also without the aid of makeup. Yes, I play the Good Fairy, and in this production, I'm the Spirit of the Bells. But it's very like
it's
the fairy
It's a pub just down the road. The bells. You
must have been there. Isn't she funny?
There.
Wait till I get you home.
She's trying hard.
Yes, she is.
You started off for Edinburgh, didn't you?
Edinburgh Festival in 1974.
The famous Edinburgh International
where we
Festival.
Were rediscovered. Yes.
Rediscovered.
Well, of course, we'd had our opera career before that, you see.
Do you go back to Edinburgh?
Not if we can possibly avoid it.
We like Scotland, because the doctor is partly Scot. Well, she's
well, entirely Scottish.
She's entirely Scottish.
All of me.
You don't sound it, darling. Where do your costumes come from? They're lovely.
These came from Lincoln, Ian B's wardrobe.
Yes. Ian B, who put the pantomimes on, supply the costumes. The jewels are my own, but the costumes.
And the plastic beads are mine.
Jewels.
Mine. Plastic beads. Black plastic.
Yes. But the costumes
I couldn't get
belong
any puppets.
To their wardrobe, you see.
And Ian B, for those who don't know, is the Paul Elliott.
Elliott and Burr. Yes, yes, that's right.
In the 22 years you have been in this business, since the Edinburgh Festival,
yes, yes.
How has it changed for you?
Changed a lot. Well, for us, personally, not that much. I mean, we've done a lot of wonderful things we've enjoyed doing, but the business as such, the theatre, has changed enormously.
When you use some of your material on TV, do you find you can't use it in the theatre? A lot of people say they have that problem.
As a general rule, you find that television does consume material at an enormous rate, and of
yes.
course, one can't really then go on stage and do the same thing, because everyone says, every time we see them, they do the same thing.
And your voice.
Yes.
Because you have a marvellous voice, and you used to do opera.
Yes.
Where did you learn?
Well, I trained in Italy.
Italy
with Signor Ernesto Bonorovoce.
You'd like to say it again faster.
Signor Ernesto Bonorovoce.
Lovely.
Yes. And he was a marvellous man, wonderful man.
He gave you everything, didn't
he? Did. Oh, yes, yes. He was a big man. I was under him for 3 years. And he was so good to me. Taught me a lot. And I was very grateful for his tutelage, particularly in the rhythm method.
Oh,
because
yeah.
that is so important when one is an opera singer, you see.
Yes, the rhythm method was an unknown technique until Dame Hilda brought it back to this country.
Marvellous.
Yes, yes.
And she has practiced it the length and breadth of the country, and all around the world.
Always
with
an open window. Yes, yes. Oh, absolutely.
And you said you haven't had lessons since you were 19.
Well, I mean, that was when he died. Soon after that, Bonavoce died. And that's when I gave up my actual opera lessons.
He died from an excess of rhythm.
Yeah. Are you looking forward to the Basingstoke one?
Yes,
it's
very
the
much.
First time here.
It's the first time at the Anvil.
We always enjoy our pantomime seasons, and we're particularly looking forward to this because though I have done Dick Whittington for me, we've never played it together, so it'll be a new subject for us here together.
It's a new subject, and we're looking forward to that. And we've got a lovely cast, you know, we've got some lovely people, Buster Merryfield, and John Evans, and we've got Jane Freeman.
And of course, Maggie Moon.
Maggie Moon, of course. Traditional pantomime, you say.
And a lovely little chap playing the cat, but I can't think of his name at the moment.
Oh, he's sweet. Yes. Yeah. He's most very helpful.
Sweet. Mm-hmm. Yes. Fluffy.
Yes.
Ladies, thank you. It's been a pleasure to meet you.
Sarah, a great pleasure.
When does it start, pantomime? Tell the viewers so they can all book up to come and see you.
Well, we start rehearsals on the 2nd of December.
I think we open
about the 15th.
Yes, I think it's the 15th we open. And we run till the first week of January.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yes.
So you've got a three-week run, 2 weeks to get yourselves together.
That's mm-hmm. right.
And come and see them at the Basingstoke Anvil.
Yes, please, that would be lovely. Please do. Thank you so much.
Look who I'm with. It's Uncle Albie.
Albert.
Albert, sorry, bit of right. respect.
Yeah.
Better known as Buster Merryfield in your
spare
time. What an amazing name.
With a Y.
What an amazing name.
Well, can't do anything about it, can I?
You start with Buster, you're looking grand.
You're only saying that because it's true.
You are, you look lovely. I think you suit plum very well.
Yes, I do. It's my colour, plum.
I think it is, yes. Mm. Buster, maybe not many people know this, but you actually started, well, you didn't start off life, but not many years ago, you were a bank manager for a rather well-known high street bank.
Now, I ought to tell you to read my book. You get it all in there.
Oh, I haven't read your book.
No, it comes out October the 1st.
Talk about a plug.
Yes, but yes, I was in a bank for 40 years, can you believe? 40 years.
Wow.
But I always wanted to go on the stage.
So in 78, when you actually left, did someone just knock on the door and say, Buster Merryfield, Bank Manager of the Year?
No, we want you in our local... Nothing like that, because when I came back from the war, I realised that banking was not for me.
Mm-hmm.
But because of the help they gave me and the security afforded, I went back to the job. And, of course, I stuck that out. But by that time, I knew then that I wanted to go on the stage. So I formed my own amateur group and that sort of thing. And over 35, 40 years, ran a dramatic group, got all the experience in. And true to my mother, she told me never to give up the day job.
And so you didn't.
So I didn't. And my mother lived till 93, God bless her.
Gosh.
And, of course, when she went, within a week, I'd given my notice in. And
1 week?
1 week. And then I was on the stage at the Connaught Theatre, Worthing. And I've been acting ever since.
You've loved it ever since.
I've never been so happy, yeah.
Of course... You have to admit that Only Fools and Horses was the thing that brought you into the public eye big time, wasn't it? Because it is such a fantastic
show. You're quite right. But on the other hand, I didn't go into acting for any thoughts of being a celebrity, particularly at that age.
But that is a comedy show, but you've done a lot of serious stuff, haven't you? You've done Shakespeare.
Well, they had to typecast me, having been a bank manager for 10 years. I got jobs like priests, doctors, pathologists and things like that, because I had a little goatee beard and looked rather
smart. Which has sort of
smart.
Flourished over the years.
But then I grew it this size for a pantomime. And it was then, my leaning towards comedy was given its chance. And I auditioned for Only Fools and Horses, and I've done 10 years now.
This is history.
Yeah.
Are you going to make another series?
Well, I've been asked if I'm available for one, so that promises well, but I can't confirm anything.
Tell us a little bit about your history in pantomimes.
Well, I've done about a pantomime every year, I suppose, since, last... 8 or 9 years.
Do you enjoy the pantomime?
Oh, I do, thoroughly. I love comedy, you see.
Mm.
And it wasn't until I got into pantomime that I was able to express myself. And I did a lot of stand-up comedy, semi-professional, and things of that kind before.
That is the hardest type of comedy, isn't
it? Well, it is. It was a good training ground. And, of course, I've died the death many times.
Don't we all?
And you begin to realise that they're trying to tell me something, you know.
Move on, babe.
So I didn't continue in that line. But the comedy was in the pantomime. And, of course, Ford and Horses' Uncle Albert was a comedy role.
So, tell us the character you're playing in this pantomime.
Yes, now what am I playing? Oh, well, I'm playing Alderman Fitzwarren.
But can you just say, it was lovely to meet you, Sarah, as Uncle Albert.
Oh, good, mate.
Could you?
Lovely to meet you, Sarah.
Oh, thanks, Albie.
Kiss a kiss.
Oh, yeah.
Lovely.
It's great to meet you. Have a good run.
I will.
Cheers,
thank you very much for asking me over. Thanks.
Back at the table again, another star of the show. Some of you might not know John Evans, but you soon will.
Oh, I think so.
John Evans, you're from Liverpool, aren't you?
I am, that's right.
And they say that comedians often come from Liverpool because living in Liverpool gives you that special sense of humour.
Somebody once said that you need to be a comedian to live in Liverpool, actually, and I think that's just about right. I was coming out of my house on the way down to the theatre this morning, and there was a big crowd outside. And I said, my God, I said, has there been an accident? And the fella said, no, the fella in the top house just had his car taxed and we're all going to have a look at it, you see. So, I mean, this is the way things happen in Liverpool.
That's,
you know,
how it starts.
Yeah.
Now, listen, I know you've done a bit of a red coat job and I know you did some acting. Which came first?
I went straight drama. Acting. Straight acting came first.
In your teens?
Yeah, in my teens from school. And I wanted to go into drama college some way if I could. Straight drama, lovey and all that, you know.
And then you realised you couldn't be serious.
And then I realised, I realised I couldn't get an equity card unless I started doing the clubs and things. You see, that was the way it was
through
at
the
time. Yeah. Backdoor, something, that's what you used to say. And so I started doing the clubs and I was bitten by the bug, quite simply. Because there's no other sound like an audience laughing. You know what I mean?
No.
Unfortunately, they used to laugh when I sang, which was, you know.
As a stand-up comedian, if you have a bad night, how much does it knock your confidence for the next gig?
Well, it can do. When you first start, it used to knock me at first.
Mm.
And I found that it was the same act I do each time, just with different light and shade, you know. Essentially, the jokes are the same.
Mm.
And so you learn to realise that it's not always your fault. You can't go through life saying, that wasn't me.
No.
You know, you've got to learn from it.
And of course, audiences are always so different. That is the appeal of a live audience.
That's it.
But they're supposed to be very different in the north to the south.
Oh, they say that, people say this, but I don't think there is. I don't think there is. No, not really.
Really?
I mean,
they say the audiences in the north are the toughest.
There's a language. There's a language difference. I mean, down south, you use words that we don't use in Liverpool, like job. She got that one.
She got that one.
It's getting there now. I'll be in it.
I don't like being the only audience for a joke. I like to laugh and then go, what did that mean?
I know.
Now, John.
Yes.
Moment of fame. Granada plucked you from obscurity and put you onto a comedian show.
Oh, wonderful. Great thrill.
What happened?
Well, I did a show. Fortunately enough, in my native town. So, I mean, I knew, you know, not, I didn't know all the audience. I mean,
Hello, Mum. Hello, Dad.
Yeah, that was awful. It sounds awful. I knew the area, so I could crack on about the area.
Yeah.
People knew what I was talking about and things. Unfortunately, there was a researcher there, Mark Wells, and he said to me, do you want to have a go? And I said, yeah, terrific, because I'd watched it, you see, as a kid, 14 or 15, with all the older comics on it. I thought, God, it was such a thrill. It was wonderful. I still sort of like, the hairs in the back of my neck stand up now.
Really?
Oh, that's wonderful.
So are you looking forward to your little pantomime run?
I can't wait.
Have you done pantomime?
Yeah, I have. I've done pantomime before. It's the first one for this particular company.
Right.
And the first one in Basingstoke I've ever done. But I've done a few in the past. But I'm looking forward to this one, yeah, immensely. I've never worked with any of this cast before.
Right.
So that'll be nice.
Yeah.
Nice to have met Hinge and Bracket and things today, you know. Busted Merryfield, of course, from my own Fools and Horses.
Witty couple. Oh. I was lost with the two of them.
Yeah. Oh, no, yeah. They're funny people, funny
they
people.
Are very...
So I'm looking forward to it. I'm going to get my teeth into it, so to speak.
So what does Idle Jack do then?
Idle Jack will fall down a lot. Get lots of custard pies in his face.
Oh, really?
Run round, be chased by all and sundry, I should imagine. It's a very demanding role and something I have to get myself into, you know, from about 4 o'clock that afternoon. I mean, you just can't walk in and do a pantomime.
You can't just do that. And you can't worry about your hair, do you either?
Oh, no, don't. You've moved the gel across now.
Oh, God.
I am actually sponsored by... No, I mean, it's great. Great fun. I mean, just go in there and have some fun.
John, it's been great to meet you.
Nice to meet you,
I hope the next time I see you, you're on mainstream television.
Oh, so do I.
I met him when he was at Basingstoke.
And she interviewed me. I can say, you know, when you're doing TV and
maybe
news
we'll meet
and things.
Again. I mean, it's a small world.
And there's been something happening behind you. This is me from News at One. And I can say, that's her.
Can you see me on the news?
No, because you'll giggle all the way through it.
No. It's been good to meet you,
nice
mate.
See you. It's one of them trendy handshakes. Great.
At the A1 Roadcraft Centre here in Salisbury, we have the experts you need to get you through your test. Hourly lessons, intensive courses, theory testing, advanced driver training on cars, compulsory basic training, part 2 and advanced rider training on motorcycles, and rigid and articulated lessons for LGV and HGV. So if you want results, call the experts in car, lorry and motorcycle tuition. That's the A1 Roadcraft Centre. Free phone 0800 716 156. The Salisbury Furniture and Carpet Warehouse in Guildhall Lane, Salisbury is the in-town family furniture and carpet warehouse. Look at our products on display, all under one roof and at highly competitive prices. Look at our suite of the month. Look at that price. Look for our free measuring and estimating carpet service available day and night. Look for immediate free delivery from our large range of stock. So look, just visit our friendly in-town family furniture and carpet warehouse in Guildhall Lane, Salisbury, just 3 minutes from the Market Square, and we're open 6 days a week. So why not telephone Salisbury 415 405 That's Salisbury 415405. Access Barclay card and credit terms subject to status.
Visit the Plough Inn at Long Parish, 4 miles west of Andover. A magnificent old-world country inn set in beautiful gardens. Dine here for wonderful fresh seafood, including crab, lobster, mussels and scallops, plus a superb haute cuisine menu or delicious bar food. You could relax at the Plough Inn Long Parish 7 days a week. So for that sensational meal, fine wine or well-kept real ale, call us now on Long Parish 01264 720 358.
Well, if you've ever lost a cat and you wonder where it's gone to, you've probably been in touch with the RSPCA. But there's also another organisation called the Cats Protection League. And it's made up of volunteers all over the country who actually look after and care for stray and missing cats. And we've come over to a location at Monxton, which is midway between Andover and Salisbury, to meet with Heather Hodgson, who actually runs this centre for cats and kittens. And we're going to go and find Heather through here. So we'll put the number up later so you can actually call Heather direct. But if you follow me... Good afternoon, Heather. Thanks for inviting us to your home.
Okay, you're more than welcome.
So what do we have here? It's quite amazing.
Well, yes, these are some of the rescue pens that are owned locally by the Andover and District Cats Protection League, where the unwanted cats and kittens are put until new homes can be found for them, or until, with a lot of them, they've been rehabilitated and suitable for new homes, because we don't really put out anything that we don't feel is suitable for rehoming.
Sure, you're telling me you've got kittens here as well, and I can see two beautiful specimens over there looking at me.
Yes, there's a litter of kittens in there that are nearly ready for homing. They've had a bit of a setback, but they're on their way now. They've had veterinary care.
Tell me about the Cats Protection League. I think it's a wonderful organisation.
The Cats Protection League is it's a nationwide organisation that covers the whole of the country, with voluntary groups forming separate self-funded groups, you know, throughout the country. Mm-hmm. The main concerns of the Cats Protection League really is the welfare of cats and kittens, whether they're ones that need in rehoming or whether they're just in general sort of a need of care or advice from people that have got them and maybe can't afford to get them neutered or get proper veterinary care, or just need advice on how to look after them.
How did you get into all this yourself? Just starting with one, did you?
Well, not really, no. I mean, I've been involved with cats sort of 20-odd years. I've had cats and been a member of the Cats Protection League. Yeah. But I think it was really after moving to this area from London and I wasn't working that I had the time to actually sort of devote a bit more into voluntary capacity.
You work with a local vet anyway,
do you? I work at one of the local vets, and of course you're in the front line then for unwanted pets when they come through, or people that are a little bit out of their depth because they're animals of bred and they don't really know what to do with all the kittens.
Has it been difficult since the RSPCA moved away from Andover?
It's made it a little bit more difficult nationally, I think, because the people find it very difficult to contact the RSPCA. The number is constantly engaged, but I always tell people to sort of plug away at it and just keep dialing until they get through. But, you know, we try to work as much as possible with the RSPCA, and we're much closer for local people to actually contact. And if a stray is picked up and handed into the vets, which they invariably are, then, you know, it's more local for people than if, you know, because we do try to reunite strays as much as possible back with their owners. Yeah. We are a little bit tied in that way because obviously every advert that we put in costs us money, but the local paper are very good and they're very supportive and they will, you know, sort of help us as much as they can to try and locate the owners.
You're saying you get some wild cats in here with litters of kittens?
We do, yes. We go out at the sort of end of the year in the winter time as much as possible. You know, a lot of the work's involved in going round to any farms that need or ask for our help, or we sort of find out if there's a farm where we can go out and perhaps help them control the numbers that they've got. And the factory sites and the army camps, because there's a lot of army sort of camps around here where...
Because people on the move all the time.
People on the move, and if the cat's not there, it tends to perhaps get overlooked, or it's perhaps a problem to take it, and somebody else is going to look after it, and then they also get a posting. Yeah. So we have had problems in the past with sort of trying to clear these sites and control the numbers. In the main, we try to do a trap, neuter and return if there's a known food source, but if there isn't, then, or if they're heavily pregnant, there's really no mileage in putting them back, because then you've got the problem in 6 months' time.
So if somebody's cat goes missing, is there a likelihood it may be here?
It's a likelihood it may be handed in, yes. I mean, sometimes you'll get people's cats that have got into a car and gone a little bit further than they should, and then people realise that they let it out, or, you know, people pick up a cuddly kitten and, you know, sort of children perhaps will play with it and then put it down a bit far away from home. So we do have a fair, you know, good success rate in reuniting lost cats with their owners, if the owners are trying to find them, you know, quite often.
But cats do tend to sort of fend for themselves, don't they?
Well, I think
to a certain extent.
Yes, to a certain extent, but I think if it's a pet that has been used to a certain lifestyle and having its food provided and its comforts provided, it finds it a bit tough. Yeah. And of course there is the fallacy that, you know, a cat will fend for itself, and we do find litters of kittens which have been dumped, which presumably, you know, the owners have thought, oh well, I'll dump it in Harewood Forest because there's plenty of wildlife there, but I mean they aren't going to survive the night temperatures as the winter progresses.
And as you say, with winter coming on.
That's right, yes. If we do get any that, you know, prove to be not tame for rehoming, then we keep them till the spring, wait till the weather gets better, and then look around for suitable outside locations where people will feed them but want something to control the rodent population. So we put them out to stables and warehouses and places like that where we know they're going to be cared for.
Well, Heather, you've been telling me you often roam around at night at 2 o'clock in the morning with one of these things. What does this do?
Well, quite often we get a call, or we'll hear of a colony of cats that need trapping and neutering. Yeah. If they're actually... I've got a food source, we'll trap, neuter, and what we call, you know, trap, neuter and return. But in order to catch them, because they're not tame, we need to use these humane traps, which we set. Well, if they're in someone's garden, that's not a problem. Right. We can show the people how to set them and then leave them until, you know, they've caught the right cat, or, you know, they've finished catching the hedgehogs, and then they'll, you know, perhaps start catching the right cat. Yeah. But if we're going out to an unsort of inhabited place where there's a colony, then we have to stay with the trap. So we usually go out in pairs and settle down with a flask and keep setting the trap, and each time we get something in one of the traps, we transfer it into a transfer cage and then reset the trap.
So how do you set the trap then?
Well, it's reasonably straightforward. The food has to go at the back, directly on the bottom of the cage, and then the trap is actually quite simple to set. I mean, they get a bit of a pounding when some of the bigger cats go in. They
get a wild cat, and it must make a bit of a
round and round. Yeah. But the idea is that you're sitting away, and then the cats will come in. You put a slight lure into the trap, and then as it goes to get the main part of the food and it steps on the pressure pad, it shuts itself in. And these are whisper traps, which are quiet, so if you've got a lot of cats to catch, then you're not going to sort of, you know, get them trap shy, because if they go bang, then the rest have disappeared into the middle distance, and you can sit there for hours then waiting for them to have the confidence to come back for the food. But we do actually maintain feral colonies once we've trapped and neutered them. If they've gone back to a source where the food may be a little bit of a problem for them to provide, then a lot of the donated food that we get, we will actually then pass on to the feral colonies for the people to put out for them. So we always maintain a colony if we put it back and make sure that it is fed and not abandoned.
Which brings me to another point. What the Cats Protection League need is money, isn't it?
Absolutely, yes, money and goods for resale, so that we can get out and raise the money to continue the work that we've been doing in the end. We work for nothing, we give up all our time voluntarily. You know, so we just need the money really to pay the vet's bills and the food bills and to keep the equipment, you know, on either improving the equipment or enlarging what we have got to make it better for the cats while they're in our care.
Okay, so at the end of the show, we'll put up the number. So make sure you're yours, Salisbury, Andover, Romsey, all those points. Ring Heather, send some money in for the Cats Protection League.
Absolutely, yes, come and become a member of the group. Yes, we've got a membership scheme, and it's £5 a year. And that we'll send you a newsletter and an update on all what we're doing in the area.
Okay, smashing, thanks. We're going to go and look over there now.
Okay,
thanks very much. Right, Heather, what's the name of this one? I understand you give everyone individual names.
Yes, give them all names, and this one's called Gabby, and the rest of her litter are in the pen in there.
So are you looking for homes for them?
Well, these kittens have all been booked now to go to new homes. There's a litter in the other pen which aren't yet ready to go. We try to take sort of reservations on the kittens when they get to about 8 weeks and then let them go at 10 weeks, because we feel the longer they're with the mothers, the better job the mothers can do than we can do. But we do have orphaned kittens as well that we hand rear. We don't do the hand rearing here because it's a night and day job. But we have got one lady that sort of stays up all the time with the hand-reared kittens until the feeds are, you know, more spaced apart.
They must almost regard you as a mother, I would have thought.
Well, the hand-rears do, they get very imprinted, and therefore we have to then find homes for them where people are either at home all day or have got other cats that they'll sort of, you know, or they go in pairs. We never home those where they're going to be alone in the daytime because they've never been left at all.
This litter you found in a part of Andover, you were telling me?
Yes, this is from a part of Andover, and the ones in the other pen with the wild mother have come from Colinbourne Deuces. They were in a shed in the garden. And, you know, it's just a never-ending problem, really, going around and answering the calls of people that get stray cats in there, especially at this time of the year. Well, we're just coming to the end now, but through the summer, every stray cat that we get sort of called out to, invariably, if it's a female, will have either be pregnant or have a litter of kittens somewhere tucked away that we have to find.
So obviously you advise people to get their cats neutered, right?
Every time. If you want a pet, then it's a neutered animal is the right pet. Yeah. I don't really feel that the old wives' tale about a female cat is better off for having had a litter of kittens, because we've got female cats that live here that have had kittens, and they're nowhere near as homely or as docile and placid as the female cats that were neutered at 6 months.
Really?
Yeah.
So if somebody wants a kitten and you've got some spare, how do they get in touch with you?
Yes, they can apply to us and we'll go through the normal procedures of finding out what type of home is on offer. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We don't believe that there is such a thing as a good free home, so we do make a nominal charge. And the kittens and the cats go out on an adoption procedure where we are doing checks before and after. Okay. And with the kittens, we are always going to check that that has been neutered at 6 months.
Okay, so can you give us a telephone number?
Yes, they can reach me here on Andover, 710-013.
710-013.
That's right, and there's an answer phone if no one's here.
Okay, so that's Heather Hodgson at the Cats Protection League here in Monxton. But give her a buzz, just repeat the number once more.
It's Andover 710-013.
710-013, and Gabby's having a great time there. So thanks very much for talking to us. It's absolutely amazing thing you're doing here. Well, thanks very much.
It's a lot of satisfaction in doing it too.
Okay. Thanks very much indeed.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
I'm Jonathan Faulkner with a review of this week's news from the Andover Advertiser and Salisbury Journal. Andover County Councillor Phil Dunn, disgusted by pornography on the internet, wants the government to exercise tighter control on the technology. In the short time I have been accessing the net, I have been shocked, horrified and sickened by some of the literature and images available to anyone, irrespective of age or cultural values, said the councillor. He's concerned that as computers increase in the home, more and more young people will be accessing the net. He added that parents must take an interest and exercise strict control over what their children are accessing. Bird feeding residents of Andover's Acre Court have let fly today because the Test Valley Borough Council has told them they can no longer give food to the creatures outside their flats. Housing manager Nick Fry said too much uneaten food was encouraging rats and other rodents into the gardens. Albert Golding, aged 86, is one elderly resident who took pleasure in giving food to his feathered friends. "We haven't got any garden," he said. "There is so much nonsense like this going on, and people are getting very worried." Long-time Luggershall Parish Councillor Eric Level has been honoured Coronation Street Alf Roberts style by having a housing development named after him. The proposed new housing area in Luggershall, where the Chalice shop once stood, is set to be called Level Court, if planning permission is given. I'm very flattered, he said. I appreciate it, but it's taken me quite by surprise. Andover is way behind the times in providing transport for physically handicapped residents, according to local voluntary group Andover FAB, which promotes integration for physically handicapped and able-bodied people. Chairman John Skerritt said there was a shortage of specially adapted taxis for wheelchairs and a need for a specialised bus service, which many towns in Hampshire already have. Committee member Julia Lloyd said that in other respects, Andover had dramatically improved, such as town centre shop access, the development of shop mobility, and most importantly, local attitudes. People in Andover are fantastic, she said. It's a lovely country town and people do care about each other. Anxious local people had the chance to air their grievances about the invasion of the Weyhill Rothsay Hotel by up to 200 Newbury bypass guards at a special meeting recently. Two representatives of Pinkerton's were on hand to answer questions. Pinkerton's marketing manager Tim Whitfield said, I had feared that we would be given a rough ride, but in the main, the residents were reasonable and sensible, and the onus is now on us to demonstrate that our declared intentions to make positive contributions are real. Police closed a road near Tidworth on Saturday night after a pallet of 18 live artillery shells were dropped from a plane. The incident was part of an Operation Iron Cyclone, but the drop from a Hercules transport aircraft went wrong when the parachute failed to open and the ammunition fell short of the drop zone. Bomb disposal experts from Tidworth carried out a controlled explosion, while the police closed the A338 for a time. Ricky Rogers, the former mayor of Salisbury, has finally reached his appeal target of £50,000 to buy a mobile education centre for Wiltshire schools. The cause, which was generously supported by members of the public and local businesses, raised the money to buy the Caravan Star Centre, which will tour schools educating children about drug and solvent abuse and providing HIV prevention programmes. The number of old people given care in privately run homes by Wiltshire County Council is to be slashed because of a £600,000 cash crisis in the county's social services. Social Services Committee Chairman Vicky Landell-Mills blamed the crisis on the lack of government money to help councils look after an ever-increasing ageing population. Salisbury closed-circuit television cameras caught two semi-naked revellers running around the city centre in the early hours of Saturday morning. The police who caught the man and woman, who were naked from the waist up, told them to cover up and sent them on their way. And finally, an Andover man got stuck in more than just traffic on the M4 on Wednesday evening. After his car suffered a puncture, he stepped out and got his foot caught in a drain. The fire service were called by a passing motorist alerted by a help sign in the car's rear window. His two passengers, both wheelchair-bound, were unable to help. But afterwards, Chippenham fire officers remarked, "It was not a drain on our services." That's it for the news this week. I'm Jonathan Faulkner.
Right, here we are. Here's a moment you've all been waiting for. We've got the Stranglers just to go on stage. There's JJ over there. Just turn the camera around and look at that man over there. And a big wave. Thanks a lot. Come back in now, Trevor. So they're just about to go on stage and we're going to follow them on stage. But no filming on stage. Strict orders, because this is the Stranglers. It's really exciting backstage at a Stranglers gig. That's what we do on Town TV, Trev. That's what we do on Town TV, we go everywhere. But it's all down to Steve, the cameraman. Steve's not on camera, man. Steve's not on camera now, Trev's on camera. And we're just waiting for the Stranglers to go on stage. This is JJ, the Stranglers bass guitarist. He's just about to go on stage now. And we're going to be filming this, so... go on, Trev, keep walking. Up, watch this. Here's the Stranglers! We bring you everything on Town TV, a Stranglers live gig.
Bad money, you need to advertise. Can you see me laughing? This is no easy ride. I'm alive.
too long. Jeans can take my breath, for my life, any place, any time. Help me out of my chair, did you think it was funny? Talking money, money, don't reptize. Can you see me laughing, 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 laughing?
Well, the weather's turned a bit, hasn't it?
It's getting cold.
Put the heating on.
That's why we're inside, not out in the back garden this week.
Yeah, we're not brave enough to do that.
Well, because we forgot our woolies.
Yeah, we did. We did. Anyway, you're all wanting to know who's won this wonderful £150 worth of table from our good friends over in Salisbury.
Yep.
So we're going to do the draw. And, of course, the answer was very, very simple. I don't think anybody got it wrong, in actual fact.
No, everybody got it right.
Yeah, and the answer was, of course, the Beatles. No, it wasn't. It was Oasis. But you're all, of course, you're all right. So here we go. It was an exciting. Should have a fanfare, really, shouldn't we?
Well, we should do.
But anyway, this is great, great. Who has won this? It's a Salisbury number. Mark Venning. Mark Venning from Salisbury. You've won that wonderful coffee table. You can have
it stained
whatever colour you want. Well done, Mark. More and more Salisbury people are going in for these competitions.
Yeah,
that's
indeed
incredible. Well done, Mark. We'll give you a buzz. Right, a new competition. We've got... You know where Middle Wallop is, don't you?
Of course.
Yeah. It's between Andover and Salisbury.
I pass it nearly every day.
On the crossroads.
Yes.
They're used to seeing town TV vehicles whizzing through there. We've got a meal for two at the George in Middle Wallop. Now, the George... It's a bit like Georgian Thruxton. It's been totally refurbished.
Mm-hmm.
And it's meant to be stunning. And I met with the manager the other day, and he said, we're going to give away a lovely two meals, a meal for two, I should say, plus a bottle of wine.
Yep.
And that's going to be great. And also, we've got a bonus prize as well, haven't we?
Yeah.
Where is it? Oh, this.
Oh, these.
Yes, show them to the viewers. We'll do a big close-up on these. But two wonderful gold watches. Look at those. I mean, I don't know whether they're solid gold, but they look stunning. So when you're sitting down enjoying your meal for two at the George at Miller Wallop, you can also be wearing those.
You'll know what
priceless.
It's closing time.
That's right. Yeah. You'll know when it's closing time. Yeah, so those are thrown in. Where did they come from?
They came from the trading post. Good old Vince over in the trading post.
Trading post in Salisbury?
In Salisbury, yeah.
So there we are. Meal for two at the George in Miller Wallop, plus a bottle of wine, and wonderful ladies and gents watches. And... what's the question this week? I know what the question is. It's to do with George, isn't it?
George.
And you've seen the paper today. There's a photograph on here. There's a character there. We'll try and do a close-up on that for you. But he was a singer in a band called Culture Club back in the 80s. And he's now a sort of solo singer, isn't he?
He is, yeah.
But what was his name? Something George. We can't be saying simpler than that. So anyway, all those prizes for that simple answer. Who was a singer in Culture Club back in the 80s? Ring us now on Andover 390.
390.
Or Salisbury 555.
222.
Or fax us on Andover 390.
391.
Or write to us at P.O. Box 555 in Andover. So there we go.
Yeah. Another show showed.
Yeah, another show showed.
Yeah.
Jason and Sarah are off to film the Pusey Carnival, I think, this weekend.
Yeah. That's always very good.
That's going to be really good. Lots of other things on Town TV. Steve's editing more of The Stranglers, so I might bring you some of that as well. So, there we go. It's over and out for us, isn't it?
Yes.
So, we'll see you later. Bye.
Don't stray too far.
to hear when they had to clear the head and redefine. Spent the day in my life to talk about money. Do you need to advertise? Or can you see me laughing? This is no easy ride.
Here is the weather forecast provided by the Met Office at Southampton Weather Centre. Saturday, mostly cloudy with a few scattered light showers and the occasional sunny interval. Maximum temperature 17 Celsius in a moderate northeast wind. Sunday, a cloudy morning with showers or longer spells of rain, but brighter later. Highest temperature 17 Celsius in fresh northeast winds. The outlook for the rest of the week: dry with sunny spells on Monday and Tuesday, but then becoming unsettled with rain at times.